Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. It is really a privilege to be here. And in March, I was formally appointed a joint professor here, and I was supposed to come for the summer school. My health prevented me from doing that. Now I am here. This is the first time for me here, and it's a real pleasure to start this position by me with this induction week for you. I think that my personal motivation when I am supposed to teach is always learning. I love learning. I don't love working too much, including teaching, but I certainly love learning. And what I wish is that it is going to be educational experience for all of us, including yourself. But I am not to teach you. We are here to learn something. What I am planning to do in this lecture is inspired and informed by certain things. And I think it is important intellectually to be fair and acknowledge what informs what you are to say. Certainly the experiences of the negotiation of the convention itself, which negotiations were a life-changing experience for many of us, including Gerald, who had the opportunity to participate in the process. It was a very unique process in the United Nations. Also, my opportunity to be a member for 2 years of the Treaty Body gave me some information and inspiration certainly informs the lecture. My lived experience as a person with psychosocial disability are at the roots of everything I can see around myself in terms of rights of persons in general, rights of persons with disabilities in particular, about an inclusive society contrasted to the society we live in, which is still very much based on exclusion of all Jews who are othered by a little so-called majority of people. Just for those who are not yet familiar with the modern terminology, psychosocial disability, I think, is a rather brand new expression. A little bit oversimplifying, and say that people with long-term mental health issues, long-term mental illness, are people who we call in the disability paradigm people living with a psychosocial disability. So using the outdated terminology, medical terminology, I am a person who was diagnosed with long-lasting mental illness at the age of 16, and I have been living with that condition. But what I experienced is that while some periods of depression or some periods of very high moods may be difficult, my real participation in society, when I'm equal to others, was mostly inhibited not by the condition, but by barriers which are around people who are having these conditions, like any other disability. So this is what we call psychosocial disability. And the advocacy work which I have been doing at the grassroots and regional arenas, obviously also informed this lecture. Additionally, my original background was in theoretical physics, so I was very much into research. My brain was trained how to do research, how to observe things, how to try to explain them. And when we come to this field, which is different from physics, I think much more exciting, the question is no longer how to explain, it's not sufficient. Explain a lot of things, we want to change the roles. We want to make it really inclusive and just for all, including all persons with disabilities. Disability studies is a very dynamic new academic field, interdisciplinary field, which aims at not only understanding disability as a social phenomenon, but also challenging societies who are not including all things. presentation is we will start with looking into the human rights model of disability. You are not supposed to know what disability is. At this stage, I will tell for those of you who are not masters in this field, what does the convention say about who people with disabilities are and what we can learn about its approach on disability and persons with disabilities. Those of you who heard something about the convention, you certainly heard this phrase that this convention is a paradigm shift in our understanding of people with disabilities. I will briefly address what this paradigm shift really means. Then, briefly, I will give a bird's eye view on a global context in which people with disabilities live worldwide. Because if we want to understand what are the contemporary issues in disability law and policy, we have to have some information about where we are and where we want to be. Then, using more human rights technical term, I will address the issues which are up to immediate realization. In the field of human rights, the history of human rights evolved in a way that they made a distinction between two categories of human rights: civil political rights on the one hand, and economic, social, cultural rights on the other hand. And while civil political rights are immediately realizable, their implementation shall never depend on resources, and no delay is allowed. Economic and social cultural rights require resources, cannot be implemented overnight, they must be realized progressively. Now we will see that the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities goes beyond this outdated approach to dividing human rights, which are interdependent, indivisible, universal, interrelated, into these two distinct categories. Yet, we can identify aspects or issues which are up to immediate realization and others which shall be implemented progressively. So first we will start with identifying some issues, also based on a description or understanding of the global situation of persons with disabilities, which must be immediately realized. No state party who ratifies the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities can find any excuse not to do the realization now. And then we will look into some other issues, some other aspects which are up to progressive realization. And I hope to finish or conclude my lecture with raising the question of how can we achieve a just society for all persons with disabilities. Now, you may say that this is a little bit megalomanistic plan, and I admit that this is true. Last night, Gerard asked me, what are you exactly going to talk about? And I told him that not everything. And it was half a joke and half not a joke. From this outline, you can see that I really try to aim at giving you a very large scale, hopefully comprehensive image about the issue as it is globally. And then I will pick up some concrete aspects of human rights of persons with disabilities, some specific rights, and I will use them as illustrations to have some learnings which I intend to be the core message of today's presentation. So let me start with the human rights model of disability. First of all, it's important to acknowledge that the Convention does not give a formal definition on what disability is. This human rights model of disability, you can understand if you read the Convention as a whole, not only the letters, but also the spirit of the convention. And you will find guidance, because there is a dedicated article written about the purpose of the convention, Article 1. All these together define what the convention's approach to persons with disabilities is, and from these you can deduce this human rights model. The convention does recognize that disability is an interaction. It's an interaction between an impairment, which can be anatomical or functional, physical. It can be real, or it can be perceived, presumed impairment. And the interaction is between the impairment and various barriers in the environment, which hinders, the interaction hinders the full and effective participation in society. So the disability is not the impairment. A blind person is not a person with disability because of the impairment of his or her vision. The disability comes from the interaction with barriers, from the fact that when we build up our society, when we build up our environment, then for centuries we were thinking only about sighted people, and we simply forgot or didn't want to include blind people. And the interaction between the barriers and the impairment will be the thing which really prevents or restricts the person's full and effective participation. Now it is very close to something which was called in the disability studies literature as the social model of disability. Instead of blaming the person with impairment and localizing the problem in the individual, the social model said, no, the problem is not in the individual, the problem is in society. The society is not responsive to the needs of the person. The criticism of the social model was basically that the social model, when it is driven to the extremes, may completely forget about the impairment. So the approach which the convention adopted is the human rights model, which acknowledges that impairment has a role, but actually it is not the individual with the impairment to be blamed. And the solution is not fixing or correcting the individual with the impairment, but the solution is to accommodate, to change, to make it accessible for all persons with disabilities. And the aim is to ensure that all persons with any kind of disabilities can enjoy all their human rights and fundamental freedoms on an equal basis with anyone else. And the convention needs to be taken seriously. When it says all, means all, which among ourselves is quite seldom, even in human rights. Very often, when the normative text in a convention says all, has been interpreted that yes, for all but, and then some exception here. And very often people with disabilities, especially people with certain kinds of disabilities, were understood among the exceptions. And the CRPD was exactly necessary to ensure that these exceptions are no longer permissible. The CRPD also acknowledges, and I think that this must make us very humble, that disability is an evolving concept. What we understand about disability today is significantly different from what we understood about it 20 years ago, and very likely is very different from what we understand under disability exemption rules from now. And actually, we have a good reason to believe that the evolution will speed up. Because now we have a new instrument, legally binding exemption rules in the convention in place, and I didn't double check how many states parties we have right now. But the majority of the members of the China, and they are in the process of quite speedy ratification. Also, it is a little bit risky to say this here in Ireland, where colleagues have been waiting for the Irish ratification for too long. Yet, I think the pace of ratification worldwide is unprecedented. It's a very speedily ratified. And because we have these international legally binding instruments, I do expect that through the implementation, we are going to speed up in changing our environments, changing our communities' attitudes, really building up more inclusive societies, facing the real difficulties, gathering the existing knowledge and looking into the existing knowledge through new eyes, open-minded eyes, informed by the Convention, and that will enrich our understanding and change our understanding of what disability really means in the very foreseeable future. When the Convention opened for signature, which is the very first important symbolic international event after the adoption of the Convention, the High Commission of Human Rights described this treaty as a paradigm shift. I think this paradigm shift has a number of elements. One element is that the CRPD is not a convention on disability. It's not a document. It's a treaty, a human rights treaty, about the rights of persons. Also, if you look into the article, it describes the purpose of the Convention and also gives a quasi-definition. It doesn't define disability. It gives an exemplary sort of explanation of who, as a minimum, should be understood as persons. I think it's an important distinction to make. It's not about the family of disability. It's not about the social burden of disability. It's about people and their rights. And that's a paradigm shift in our thinking about disability, because for decades in international policy, then different intergovernmental agencies and organizations, and then national governments and policymakers were working on creating better policies reflecting the needs of persons with disabilities. They were mostly thinking about disability, and they wanted to alleviate the burden of disability in societies. This approach, if you think a little bit about it, if disability is a burden in society, then who is a person? Isn't the person then the one who manifests, who embodies, who is the holder of the burden? I think, as a person with disability, many of us really experience that they didn't like this language, talking about the burden. Although, rationally, I understand what the policymakers meant using that term. But this terminology still exists, and the paradigm shifts do not happen overnight. Sometimes the old generation has to die out, and the new generation hopefully will grow up with the new paradigm. So it's about the rights of persons with disabilities, and it's both rights. It's not about needs. Again, I think it's a very important distinction. If something is recognized as a right, then it means that is not up to any further negotiation. When something is recognized in a binding instrument as a right, then the negotiations belong to the past. There is an agreement that societies must guarantee those needs which are reflected in the rights. So I am not bargaining about my needs. As a person with disability, I am asserting my rights, which gives me an entirely different position. which in reality and in practice, you know, they still be difficult because the government will still say that, we have so many problems. In this very difficult economic situation, there are homeless, there are these groups and those groups. We will come back to you at some point. So just asserting my right does not necessarily give me practical tools, but it gives me a very dignified position. And it gives me a different societal, if you like, a different political currency. Persons with disabilities are no longer objects of charity, exactly because the Convention is about the rights, which are not up to any negotiations, but we are subjects of law on an equal basis, which again has these two sides. I am a right holder and a duty bearer. I am not being as much keen on being a duty bearer, but that's also part of the duty. I think it belongs to my dignity. It's not only a duty. On an equal basis with others. This is a recurring phrase in the Convention. What does it exactly mean? That on the basis of disability, there shall never be any negative distinction made. And obviously it's about non-discrimination, it's about equality, but it is not only about formal equality, it's about de facto equality. Laws and policies, when the CRPD is in force, should provide with effective measures to achieve this de facto equality of all persons with disabilities. And I emphasize that all persons with disabilities. And I think it's very important. Very often, even we, persons with disabilities, and our organizations tend to forget, not deliberately, but still tend to forget some of our goals. People with intellectual disabilities who are not very well represented in most national cross-disability organizations. If they are, they are typically represented by their parents. Self-advocates with intellectual disabilities is an emerging movement, but in most places they are not very easy to hear yet in the cross-disability. So if this is what happens in our world, then it should not be very much surprised that this happened in society at large, including the policy makers. We talk about all persons with disabilities, regardless of the severity of the disability or the impairment, regardless of the functioning of the person with disability, and so on. Now, the next slide is an image of a tree. And I think it's not accidental that from ancient times, in many different cultures, tree was used as a metaphor for life. I will use the metaphor of tree to make a link with the life and participation of persons with disabilities in community, on the one hand, and also we can think of the Convention as a tree. So the tree will be the metaphor for the Convention as well. What we want to achieve, and that is the contemporary challenge before all of us, is to have a tree which has everything it needs for an organic function, from roots up to the fruits. And the full implementation of the CRPD can be seen as we as good gardeners do everything what is required to ensure that the tree will be an organic tree and will produce nice fruits. What is the current situation? Well, a tree is not a really well-functioning organ. Based on the WHO's recent feasibility work report, and also some information from the UK Department of International Development, I just picked up certain very sad and dramatic facts. More than 1 billion persons with disabilities worldwide exist. So the population of the world is somewhere between 6 and 7 billion, and more than 1 billion of them are persons with disabilities in the understanding of the CRD. About 110 to 190 million of these people, including myself, experience very significant difficulties in their participation in society. Disability disproportionately affects vulnerable populations, rural populations, women and girls, those who are already in poverty, ethnic minorities, religious minorities. You can continue listing any kind of vulnerable populations. There is statistical evidence that in those populations, the likelihood that someone is a person with disability or will become a person with disability is significantly higher than in more fortunate sectors and segments of society. 80% of persons with disabilities live in developing countries. And most of developing countries are poor. Low income. 10,000 persons with disabilities, I repeat, 10,000 persons with disabilities die every day due to extreme poverty. No problems. People with disabilities have significantly less opportunity to access health care, education, employment, social security, and services. Large number of people, mostly with intellectual and psychosocial disability, are deprived of the right to political participation. They are deprived, or they can be at least deprived, of the most basic democratic right, the right to vote. Many adults with disabilities are treated before the law as if they were children, I mean before the law, not in attitudes, legally, under the law. For the law, their legal status is the same as if they were minors. Their adult personhood is not recognized. Many children and adults with disabilities are deprived of their dignity. I don't know how many, and I don't think there is anyone in this globe who knows exactly how many people are locked up in psychiatric facilities. How many people spend their entire lives in long-term residential institutions, formally consented to be placed there by a third party, a desperate parent, or a family member, or someone, but not the person who knows herself. All of these people are deprived of their living. Many people are treated inhumanely in institutions and in the community. Only in a very few countries we have some knowledge about how children and adults with disabilities are treated at home or in the neighborhood. It's not nice. And anyone can continue this. Really, more or less randomly selecting only some facts as indicators to describe that the global context, which is the basis for the lived experiences and realities of people with disabilities across the globe, is very far away from a just society. So if we look at the real tree, you can see a tree which is somewhat distorted because it has been for a long time in a permanent storm. Now, what can we do? How can we use law and policy change the situation. The situation must be changed. Not only because the convention is there, the convention is in force globally. Hopefully, Ireland is going to ratify the convention in the foreseeable future, so it will be in force drastically as well. We must change just because our conscience, after facing all these facts, can't be good if we are not doing something to change. So first let us see, and let us do it in a reflective manner. You are LLM students, you are law students. Let's look at the possible things we can do in a pseudo using, among other things, the convention in the rights of persons with disabilities to contribute to those changes. Many of the CRPD articles are hybrid in nature. This means that you cannot clearly say that this article is about the civil political right or this article is about economic social. For instance, if you look at the right to employment, which is traditionally a very clear example for the social economy of the right, in the CRPD, it appears also as a non-discrimination measure. Now, non-discrimination is something which should be realized immediately. No state can say that, look, I have resources. That is why I continue discrimination in my legal and policy relations. It's not allowed. So while right to employment itself is social economy, the article in the CRPD, which is about it, also contains non-discrimination, which is up to the individual. And there are some articles, and we will see the right to live in the community, the right to live independently and be involved in the community, as I think a very good and sophisticated example on how intimately interlinked or intertwined the civil, political, and social economic aspects of a CRPD article can be. But again, I want to emphasize that all the civil, political aspects of any of the articles in the Convention are up to immediate realization. And this includes non-discrimination, and a very important thing is that the Convention acknowledges and recognizes that the denial of reasonable accommodation is discrimination on the ground of disability. What is reasonable accommodation? I am sorry, and that I apologize to the disability law and policy students who may be very well familiar with this. But reasonable accommodation is another relatively new concept, so we can't expect that everyone understands what it is. If you go to the real policy world, then you will meet many people with goodwill who have hardly ever heard about reasonable accommodation. Many people with disabilities themselves have never heard about reasonable accommodation. Reasonable accommodation is any adjustment or modification which is required by the person with disability to ensure that he or she can enjoy his or her rights on an equal basis with others. If these accommodations, adjustments, and modifications do not represent an undue burden or hardship, that is why we call them reasonable, then this is something which must be provided to the person. And the denial of this provision under the Convention is seen as discrimination. So it's very important, maybe conceptually a bit tricky, something. It's not sufficient for them to refrain from doing something. We have to do it. We have to change. We have to accommodate. We have to adjust, modify, if it is not already there. And yet, it's denial, it's discrimination. So, reasonable accommodation must be provided now. It is up to immediate accommodation. Let's look into some concrete articles or rights in the convention which are also up to individualization. Yes?
How does the CRPD define undue burden or hardship? Because it seems like that could be a very easy excuse for any country or
The answer is very simple, but not very satisfactory. The CRPD does not define it. It is left up to the jurisprudence. Yes, there is a threat. There is always a threat, you know, that when I claim my right to reasonable accommodation and want an accommodation, then the other party will say that, look, it's not reasonable. Well, now the existing jurisprudence in those parts of the world where we have reasonable accommodation legislations and jurisprudence is that it is not you who have to prove that it is reasonable. It is always the other party who have to give evidence that it is not reasonable. So this burden of proof, you know, is one thing which you have. And the other thing is that the existing domestic jurisprudence, I think, gives some guidance for the committee. Then they will elaborate on their own jurisprudence. And also domestically, when a country introduces reasonable accommodation legislation and the jurisprudence will start to evolve, advocates, I think, are encouraged to look into other countries' existing case law. And of course, look at the progressive case law. The committee already adopted one decision on a complaint under the optional protocol to the convention, which also raised issues about reasonable accommodation. So the jurisprudence is already emerging. And it's really up to advocates to use the convention and to force the machinery to speed up with the jurisprudence and to be careful to ensure that the jurisprudence can evolve in a really just way and not serve as an excuse for non-action. So some examples of rights which are named in the convention and which are also up to individualization. The right to legal capacity, and I will speak a few minutes about it. The right to liberty. The right to be free from torture and other forms of ill treatment. The right to participation, which is pretty strong in the convention, including political participation. What is legal capacity? If we look back at the metaphor of the tree, I would say that it is the root. Typically, we don't see its roots. Human rights, for a long time, hadn't seen legal capacity as a human right. Although it was an issue for me, and in Sydow, it emerged. And Sydow made sure that all women enjoy their legal capacity in all civil matters on an equal basis with men. Then about children in CRC, the evolving capacity of the children to be recognized. Children are not only objects. They are not only abstract right holders. They actually, proportionately with their maturity and age, they also are agents. They can have a say in shaping their own lives. Now, CRPD made this root of the tree very explicitly visible for all persons with disabilities. Legal capacity is a legal, if you like, an institutional recognition of personhood. The convention guarantees equal enjoyment of legal capacity, including the capacity to act. Legal capacity is a very dynamic and quite complex concept. Many states, when they look at the convention, they claim that, look, all persons with disabilities are, under non-domestic laws, persons before the law, because we are right holders. Just to know if someone has a very severe intellectual disability or someone who has a very severe mental illness, they cannot exercise their rights. We mandate that exercise to somebody else who will act and decide in the best interest of the person. So they cannot really have their capacity to act, but they still have it. Now, that is not compliant with the CRPD. The CRPD wants both the capacity to have rights and the capacity to exercise them recognized on an equal basis with others. The state has a duty to provide access to support to exercise it in the US. Yes, if someone has a learning disability, significant nature, may find difficult to make certain types of legally binding decisions if support is not provided. A person with psychosocial disability who has voices, hears voices which are disturbing, may find it difficult to make certain types of decisions, again, if support is not provided. So the CRPD made an obligation on the state to ensure that access to support to exercise of legal capacity is provided. Safeguards against abuse. And the greatest abuse to be safeguarded is to decide instead of the person with disability. To decide for the person with disability in the best interest of the person with disability. Keeping the person with disability aside from the decision in his or her best interest, of course. This cannot happen. This needs to be safeguarded. And the convention text also makes it clear that this full and equal enjoyment of legal capacity also covers financial matters. It also extends to access to bank loans, mortgages, and any other financial institutes which are there available for persons with disabilities. Personhood is recognized as persons with identity and persons with agency. The recognition must happen on three different levels. A Finnish disability scholars theorized on what personhood is in the light of inclusion in society. And he introduced these three levels. The first level of recognition as a person happens by the person you know himself. This is the person level. If I, who am a person with a psychosocial disability, don't believe that I am an equal person with anybody else, I'm a full person, then very little can be done for me. I have to do it. If you like, this is my own empowerment. But somehow it is also related to the psychological level. And what we can see is that for too long time, policymakers have been stuck on this level. They look into the psychological, they look into the mental capacity of the individual to see what can be done. They never reached the second level, which Pikaheimo identifies as institutional recognition of personhood. That is what the Convention, Article 12 of the Convention, which is about legal capacity, does. It gives an institutional recognition of personal rights. But that is not sufficient. Mikhailo says, if the person is not recognized as a full person at the interpersonal level, if other persons do not see the person as a person who is contributing to the common good of the community, then that person cannot really exist as a full person. Although the person may recognize himself as a full person, and even the institutions may be there. The laws guarantee that all persons' legal capacity is equal. Yet the bank will be skeptical and doesn't want to make a contract with me, because they have suspects that I am really a full person. So at the interpersonal level, the information needs to be given. Obviously, law cannot cover all of the three aspects. But law can do a lot, even on the third level. And later I will show you how. And I will talk a little bit about the right to live in the community, Article 19 of the Convention. I will try to show you that an international legal tool, law instrument, can also do something to promote and advance this interpersonal recognition of personhood, of all persons. Right to liberty is looked at by the Convention on the grounds of non-discrimination. And as we have said generically, non-discrimination includes the provision of reasonable accommodation. So whenever someone is deprived of their liberty, and the person is a person with disability, then the deprivation of liberty must happen in a way which is responsive to reasonable accommodation needs of the person. All those persons with disabilities who are involuntarily admitted to psychiatric facilities are deprived of their liberty. All those persons who are placed in long-term residential institutions, even if they are placed there on request by the parents, or any other third party, but not with a full and informed consent of the person whom or herself, regardless of what disability the person has, are people who are deprived of their liberty. Very often, the authorities will tell you that, look, we placed this poor person with very severe mental handicap. And using very outdated language deliberately to describe how much the old paradigms were there. Look, the authorities say, we did not place this person in the residential institution because of the disability. If the person had a social network, a supportive family, or something, we would be happy to serve him or her in his or her home. But unfortunately, this guy doesn't have such social support. So that is why we place the person in the institution. It's not disability only. It is disability and the lack of social support. Manfred Novak, the former special rapporteur on torture of the United Nations, made it absolutely clear that the prohibition of deprivation of liberty based on disability means that disability should never be a factor in depriving someone. It doesn't matter whatever other reasons the authorities may say. If disability is one factor, then it is in contradiction to the right to liberty as recognized and guaranteed by the Convention. The right to be free from torture and other forms of ill treatment. Actually, at least two articles of the CRPD address this. One article, Article 15, is dedicated to this issue, and there is another one, which is about the rights to integrity, right, to physical and mental integrity. The two are really intimately intertwined. Deprivation of liberty in itself can result in ill treatment, which may amount to torture. Again, Novak, a former special organ torturer, said in the report. Very simple, one famous case from European jurisprudence, actually, pre-CRPD jurisprudence. A wheelchair user is sentenced to prison, not because of the disability. Disability had nothing to do with it. So it was a lawful deprivation of liberty. But reasonable accommodation, the prison was not accessible. Okay? You can't make the prison accessible overnight. But what they could do, and they actually should have done in the light of the CRPD, is to provide reasonable accommodations to do what can be done right now. Reasonable accommodation is up to immediate accommodation. To ensure that the person with disability could use the toilet, could use any other facilities in a dignified way. No, none of this was provided, and the European Court of Human Rights found in the case that just because the environment in which the deprivation of liberty happens was not at all responsive to the internal needs of the person, the deprivation of liberty automatically resulted in ill treatment, in human behavior. Any medical or other treatment which happens without free and informed consent of the person and which is aimed at alleviating or correcting the disability is ill treatment, which again may amount to torture depending on the circumstances. And there are unfortunately bad examples for this for different groups of people with impairment, people with disabilities from across the globe. One typical group who face this situation are again people with psychosocial disabilities, people with mental illness using medical terminology, psychiatric patients. In every country still, involuntary treatment is lawful and is in conflict, is what we can say, with the CRPD. Mendes, who is the current special rapporteur on torture of the United Nations, went a little bit further and he expressly said that no severity of a mental illness or risk to self or others argument can ever justify such an involuntary treatment. This is a huge paradox, because whatever international or regional human rights instrument we look into, in the pre-CRPD era, people of unsound mind, which basically covers two groups using the disability terminology, people with intellectual disabilities, people with psychosocial disabilities, they were included in the exception process. The CRPD approach is quite different and the consequences is quite different. What is lawful under the old paradigm can easily be unlawful under the new paradigm. It's difficult to grasp. The right to participation, including political participation. There are at least three relevant articles which address elements of participation. There is one dedicated article which is about political participation. Then there is a provision in the general obligations which is about the duty of the state to closely consult with and involve persons with disabilities in their representative organizations in every decision which you have an impact on their lives. And there is a provision in the convention on the national level monitoring of the implementation of the treaty, which again has an obligation on the state to do that monitoring with an active participation by persons with disabilities and their organizations. Now, if you look at the political participation part or aspect, then we can see that it is both about the passive and active severity and the nature or type of the impairment or any other condition shall have the right to participate in the open. It is also about that they can stand or even the person, again, I deliberately use out the terminology, with the most severe mental retardation. That is what the CRPD says. Isn't it stupid? Isn't it crazy? Many people's first response is that. And frankly, I can understand it. I mean, if something is a paradigm shift, then you cannot really digest it. You need to make an effort to digest it. If you first time read the CRPD, and you read it not only mechanically, but use your brain. And if you don't feel at the gut level a response saying that, oh, it's stupid, then you didn't even start this thing. I think that every one of us has to go through that stage. First, it looks crazy. Then, you will talk to others, you will read, you will reflect, you consult, and then you grow in your understanding. And hopefully reach a stage when you will ask, my earth, how could I have thought about these issues so differently 10 years ago? I do hope that this is going to happen, but it's really shocking the first year. The answer I can give to this, isn't it crazy? You know, people with most severe mental retardation can go for elections? Isn't it dangerous for the stability of society? I would say that if a society is stable, if it is democratic, if it is working on the basis of the rule of law, it has no risk at all. Because you are running for the election, but if other people, the electors, will think that you are not capable, not only because of an impairment, but to any reason, you are not capable of being responsible, accountable, transparent, representative, and you're not many people. But of course, we have to believe in human rights and in the rule of law and in democracy. Sometimes, you know, it's too much. It may sound too idealistic, but we have any other alternative. We have to work. And we work on human rights, and we work on the rights of persons with disabilities. We work on something which is only one part, and not an isolated part, of a much larger game, which is human rights, rule of law, democracy, meaning something. Accessibility and reasonable accommodations must be provided. It is not just enough to recognize the right to political participation. If the voting booths are not accessible, that will be a problem for many disabilities. But again, in many countries, there are people with disabilities who do not reach the stage to have access to the issues because they are legally excluded. People with intellectual disabilities. The right also includes the right to hold public office. Well, a person with an intellectual learning disability running for president's office. Okay. So, why not? What happens then? You should try to experiment with it and wait a few generations, and maybe one day this will become happen. Just started to understand that people with intellectual disabilities is a very heterogeneous group. And what we understood under intelligence is not that relevant. Most people make most of their decisions, including our accountable and responsible politicians who are not persons with disabilities, mostly not based on rational cognitive function. We are just at the very early stage of exploring human decisions. It turns out that human intelligence is much broader than just IQ, as it has been seen. So I can think that one day, a country may be so privileged that they will have president who is a person with intellectual ability and who has very good strength in certain, maybe until now, hidden, unexplored components of intelligence, which would be him or her a very good president. Of course, supports and accommodations filled in place. It's very important, and that is why I spent a relatively long time on this political participation issue. Near the end of my lecture, which will come in half an hour, and then we will have an opportunity for interaction, I will address this issue that why are the changes so slow? What are the barriers to changes? And one element you will see there is that on some issues, political will is not strong enough. There may even be political will, so I can't say that there is no political will. But there are so many competing political interests in a real society, especially in an economically difficult situation right now, for instance. If a group has little political weight, it's very unlikely that that group's interests will be given the same weight by the political elites as more politically impactful groups. So it's really crucial, first stage, to remove all the legal barriers to become political. Let us stop here for questions and answers before I move to some issues that will be shorter, which are to be progressively asked. If you have any questions or issues in the
next year, taking the example of a person with a social disability, how does the convention expect practically to have the consent of such person obtained for medical health? Suppose the consent must be personal, voluntary, and no third party consent is accepted. The same as saying that the person won't be treated because I have not known the person under that condition who accumulated that under that condition and is treated. It's only after he has could be left it that I'm
accumulated. Very good question, very difficult question also. But very good, because trying to give an answer, I think I can address some more general issues as well. Very often policymakers ask us, what does the convention say? How shall we do this? And very often what we have to say is that the convention doesn't tell you. The convention is not a cookbook. The convention is an international human rights treaty. The highest level in the most global level, normative legal framework. Such an instrument is not fit to give you the house, because the house can be very different, you know, in different parts of the world, in different cultures, in different implementations of healthcare, etc., etc. This is part of the answer. So the convention itself does not expressly say anything about this. But that is not really true that the convention doesn't give us guidance. Because if you look at the convention, read the convention as a whole, all the articles, and also grasp the spirit of the convention, then it gives you a good enough image to conceptualize, you know, what is not in compliance with the convention. Just saying that this person is so evidently psychotic that it makes no sense to give the information to the person, to ask the person to give the informed consent, because the person is not in the position, thank you, to give an informed choice, because the voices the person hears are so overwhelming. Simply the person will not be able to do that. But we know as medical professionals that we can stop the voices if we use an electroshock treatment or if we inject mind-altering drugs into the blood of the person. Now, this is not absolutely. If you want to have a cookbook, you have to go beyond the CRP. You have to go beyond international guidelines. You have to go to the realm of factual evidences. And if you look at the literature, there is existing literature which demonstrates that it is possible. It is possible to provide the information to the most psychotic, most acutely psychotic patients in a way based on which the person can make a decision. The problem is not with that. The problem is that then the decision of the person is different from what the doctor, the treating doctor, believes is best for the person. Then the medical professional will find it difficult to handle, to respect the person's choice. But in the end of the day, this happens in other areas of medicine as well. When a cancer patient, you know, the idea of informed consent is historically new. Before the Second World War, this concept did not exist in any other country. It's historically new. When it was introduced, it was a scandal among many medical professionals. And then cancer patients, who had a condition with almost certainty will result in the death of the patient, refused the proposed treatment. It was very difficult for the medical professionals to deal with. On the personal level, it may be still difficult for many, when a young patient says that, no, thank you, I know what the side effects are. I want to die in a dignified manner instead of being suffering from the medication. We have to respect it. It can be personally difficult, but that is the norm which was adopted. So it's not only people with psychosocial disabilities whose situation, whose decision may cause difficulties for the medical profession. It can happen. Our CRP really demands is that the norm should be the same for people with psychosocial disabilities. Now, if the informed consent process requires support, Article 12 of the Convention gives this obligation to the state to provide access to the support which is required to exercise legal capacity. If this support takes time, and there is an intervention which is a really emergency intervention, a life-saving medical intervention, which cannot wait that amount of time, then the same norms must be followed and applied, which we apply in other non-psychiatric fields of emergency medicine. In emergency medicine, the system is prepared to give prompt intervention to save the life of the person, even in situations when the person is not in the condition to be a human. What is happening currently is that absolutely different standards are used to replace the person's consent in psychiatry than in other fields of emergency medicine, which is not common in this study. One standard should be applied. And again, the cookbook, it's not easy. People have to learn, medical professionals have to learn how to communicate with person in psychosis. I would say, you know, the cancer therapist has to learn how to communicate with the cancer patient. Any other medical professional has to learn how to communicate with his or her patients. Why do we want to give an exception to psychiatry? Too problematic for patients. You are not expected to communicate. So what is required may be technically difficult, but common sense logic says that that is what we should have done ever. And we did not do that. was too easy to say that, oh, mad people, mentally ill people belong to a different category. The norm for the others is this, and we are the exception. This is no longer possible. And there is research. I am personally familiar with some Norwegian research who obtained informed consent and tested whether the informed consent was really informed consent in the most acute sample patients. And actually, the delay, which was caused by supporting the informed consent process, was not accounting for the figure, but it was not unusable at all. So very seldom we had to make real emergency interventions because they could not wait. Any other question? Yes?
Some of the criticisms that have been put forward about a human rights approach to things is that it's very individualised. And I'm interested to hear your thoughts on that criticism in the context that a lot of the barriers that you mentioned that face people with disability in society are structural. And can't really be responded to on an individual basis. It kind of requires collective, widespread responses to address those barriers. So I'm interested to hear your thoughts on how a human rights approach can kind of be used to achieve structural change and structural outcomes.
I think I will best address this question, you know, when I'm going to talk about the right to live in the community. So I continue, if you allow me, and then I will come back to your question in a few minutes, actually. So unlike the civil political aspects of human rights, the social economic aspects are up to progressive realization. Now, states, authorities, very often used the progressive realization doctrine to find excuses. All our resources are very limited, and I know no country which has unlimited resources. Resources are always limited. We will deal with this issue in the next 5 years back. No, this is not progressive realization. The Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights clearly elaborated on what progressive realization is, and based on their approach, learning from best practices in the world, the Center for Economic and Social Rights developed a very interesting instrument to test, to assess whether a state really does their best to progressively realize social economic aspects. First of all, what the states are required to do is that they introduce and implement effective measures. They undertake effective measures. Effective, not any kind of measure. They have to demonstrate that they are using measures which are indeed effective. And those measures must be used up to the maximum of available resources. So for instance, if the state says that yes, we agree that the right to inclusive education for children with disabilities is important. We really want, we have a vision of an inclusive society. We understand that this can't be achieved if children with disabilities in the schools are segregated. We feel that it's difficult. But look, we really have no resources. Now, if that state uses money, state money, public money for education, for any other group, then we are not using their resources to the maximum resources to implement their duties in the progressive realization. The recent evolving jurisprudence also says that although in totality the social economic aspect of human rights is up to progressive realization, test is the maximum available resources and effective measures, there is a certain goal which must be provided immediately. Certain amount of drinking water, certain basic amount of food, and some basic shelter must be provided even under the most unfortunate economic situations, even in the poorest. There can be no excuse of letting people die in the streets because no minimum food for survival was provided. It is an evolving jurisprudence. We do not yet know that in the CRPD, the particular specific economic social aspects, how the jurisprudence will deal, how they will establish the core which must be provided in the future. And of course this progressive realization must be monitored. And this monitoring does not necessarily have to be subjective. The Center for Economic and Social Rights developed a framework which is called the OPERA framework. OPERA comes from outcome, policy efforts, resources and assessments. The next slide is a sort of diagram. I will tell you what the diagram says. The outcome means that we have to look when we assess whether a state does their best to progressively realize social aspects, social economic aspects, right? We have to look at what is the outcome of the measures they have been undertaking. If we look into the right to education, for instance, for persons with disabilities, then we want to look into, you know, how many children with disabilities attend schools at all. How many of them attend inclusive schools? How many children without disabilities attend schools? How many of them attend inclusive schools? And we have to look at the figures in different time moments. So we have to see the trends. So we have to assess the outcomes. But we have to also look into the policy, because the outcomes typically come 5, 10, 15, sometimes even more time after the necessary policy measures are introduced. The CRPD entered into force in 2008. It will take time, we have to be realistic, it will take time, even if the best policies are introduced in the country. But the default situation is that all kids with disabilities were sent into special schools, if they were sent to schools at all, it will take some time to achieve large, great, good-looking outcomes. So we have to look into what policy efforts, what laws, programs, and other policy measures they introduced. We have to look into the resources. How much resources they made available for the implementation of policies. We have to have some information about the maximum available resources which is there. Then we can test, you know, whether they really use their resources up to their maximum to realize progressively the social aspects.
So could I ask a question?
Yes.
A lot of our legislation, as far as resources allow, or as far as is practical. Ireland, as you know, hasn't yet ratified the CRPD. When it does ratify, will that override that line in legislation? Because, for example, children with disabilities right now, the 1988 Education Act would say as far as resources allow, within roughly the EPSA Act, Education for Persons with Special Needs, that's still not implemented. So it gets a little bit frustrating because you're looking at a child with disabilities. Their time is passing by. These are critical years in their lives.
Absolutely.
And what, I mean, I suppose I'll go back to my question. Will the convention, once ratified, override national law?
Well, it's technically a very tricky question. I'm most familiar with the Irish domestic rules situation on that. From an international law perspective, I can say that yes, international human rights law will prevail in the case of conflict. But how you can really enforce it, that's another question. I have no answer to that. But for instance, if Ireland would also ratify the optional protocol, I don't know if there are any chances that this happens. Certainly when the committee will look into the country reports in the future, after ratification, then Ireland will come before the committee. Then they will look into the convention requirements. The convention requirement is progressive realization as understood under the international human rights law, and that will prevail. Now about, yes, even how progressive realization is understood in international human rights law is not giving a really satisfactory answer in the case of right to education, exactly because of the nature of the thing. That, yes, is not an answer to children and parents. Now, that yes, within 20 years, the outcome will be visible. What to do with that? So then what you can say is that, first of all, the right to education again contains a non-discrimination component, which must be immediately realized. So if a parent with a child decides to go to the mainstream school, the school cannot lawfully reject. If they do and the government allows it, then they are in breach to fit their obligation under the CRP. Of course, only after the CRP enters into force.
The practice is they can't literally refuse what they would say. Such a school down the road is better, has better resources.
I know.
Etc. And truly the parent is there and they're saying, I want the best chance for my child. So it's not the practice versus the theory, the results.
Yes, there is a gap. I do acknowledge. And what my answer would be is that international law in itself, you know, so this is not to say that international law is not useful. But that's only one and maybe not even the strongest. But important because it has a high level of status. Activism is necessary. Activism. Including litigation. But not only, but including litigation. And we need pioneers. We need pioneer parents. We need pioneer children with disabilities. We need pioneer communities. And it's very unfair to say. That is how it has happened in every social change. And it can't happen, unfortunately. I can't imagine. There is this risk, you know, that there will be countries, many countries, where parents will not be keen in doing too harsh. And I can understand that. They may fear of refugees. And as parents, we don't want retribution because retribution will be down to the child. And yet, I really do not see how without social change activism, social justice activism, making references, using the CRPD as one instrument, using pieces of domestic laws which can be used, and, using the constitutional law, which is certainly an element where, as soon as the CRPD enters into force, you know, challenging things on constitutional grounds is an area where the CRPD can be influenced. Directly, indirectly, it depends on technical leaders, which I'm not familiar with, but certainly that is the area where the system will be much more open to the CRPD modern standards. And, we must believe that changes can be achieved. If you don't believe, and you're not even try, but there is a risk that in many countries they do not even try. And I see that this risk is the highest regarding the right to education. In the case of right to employment, you know, there will be some groups of people with disabilities themselves who will be in a position to do something visible. Future users, for instance, you know, go to the streets and demonstrate and protest. It's very visible. The media likes it, you know. It's a very graphical news for the media. But right to education is it's very clear. So the last thing which, if you want to assess how well the state does with their obligation under progressive legalization, is to assess the restraints, the constraints that state has in implementation. And that is something we activists often forget. We say, look, government, we do nothing. And actually, very often the reality, the truth is in between. They do something. Maybe they do not do the most effective thing. Maybe they do not use their resources up to maximum, but they do something. What we as activists very often do not appreciate is their real objective constraints. The constraints may come from two factors, basically. One is capacity. Capacity may be resources, capacity may be about knowledge, skills, expertise. If a government doesn't have any resources to further increase the number of children in education, then you can expect very little for children with disabilities. If we are in a country where inclusive education as a concept never existed, there are no experts who are familiar with it, then the capacity issue is not only about money, it will be also about knowledge and skills. So obviously, capacity limitations need to be addressed through capacity building. The resource elements may be using international cooperation among them, possibilities. Private public partnerships may also be an option in some parts. Then, the other important constraint thing can be the political will. Some examples for issues to be progressively realized: social security, adequate standards of living, education, health, employment, access to services, including support services. I will not go into that. I will use just one of them as an example, and then I will come to the right within the community, also hopefully addressing the question you raised, and then I conclude that what I think can be done to make the world a more just society. My paradigm example regarding the progressively realizing issues is social security. And the lesson I want to learn from this is that why the so-called dream tracking policy is not as in many other areas in the implementation of the convention. We do know that the prevalence of disability is higher in socially economically disadvantaged populations. Life and social participation is more expensive if you have a disability. I think that all of you who have a disability and all of you who has a family member with a disability know it very well. Just to ensure the same level of participation in social life as the neighbor who has no disability, it costs me more because I will have some impairment related expenses. If you may spin disability into social security policies, including poverty reduction, then if you not really address this impairment. Let me tell you an example. I had the privilege to spend some time in Fiji. And Fiji has not yet ratified the convention. They are working on that. we are in the same position in that regard as Ireland. We are working for the ratification. Now, one of the measures we need is that in the past, until the end of the previous year, they had two different types of social benefits, cash benefits. One was a general anti-poverty benefit. And the eligibility criteria was that the total income per capita in the family had to be below certain threshold. And they also made some means tests. They looked into what means the family has, TV, refrigerator, car, whatever. And then they made a decision whether the person was eligible for that or not. Now they had a separate benefit, which was a disability benefit. And the aim was to at least contribute, partially contribute, to these impairment-related extra costs. Okay? And the eligibility criteria was that the severity of the impairment, the limitation, restriction to the functioning of the person, had to be higher than a certain threshold. And there was no poverty or income there because the rich person, relatively well-doing person with disability, has to pay those extra costs equal. Maybe they can afford it, but still they will use it, you know, for something which non-disabled people don't have to use. So there is an injustice element there. That was just partially compensated. And then the government of Fiji had this bright idea. We do not want to segregate this. We want to mainstream. So they ended the disability benefits. Now they have only the generic poverty benefits. Now the problem is that now there is no measure available for the person with impairment to get a compensation for the extra costs, impairment costs. So they will enter into this poverty trap. Most of them is by default poor, statistically, for example. Because of their impairment, they have extra costs. They spend the extra costs. They have less remaining for just participation in society, including employment. So they will become employed. And this is a vicious circle. So if you only mainstream social security persons with disabilities, it's very difficult to address the impairment-related extra costs. Why, I think, this twin-tracking policy is required. You have to have policies, mainstreamed policies on poverty reduction, but you have to have dedicated social measures to help people with impairments to get compensation at least partially for the impairment to the extra costs. And only if both tracks are there, then you can ensure equal and just opportunity for social participation. Now, if you look at the real situation, what has been happening in the world regarding social security, including poverty, eradication or prevention of persons with disabilities, in the post-2008 crisis, then we see no impact. Actually, even in areas, countries, where we used to have impact, we are moving away from that. And the ideology, and the key word is mainstream. It's a very tricky and risky thing. The conceptual ground for the new policy is called social protection floor. Social protection floor is a human rights based approach. The social is saying is that the core obligations coming from the social economic rights, which we spoke about, which must be provided immediately, also the rights in totality should be realized progressively. The core should be provided immediately. They should give an obligation to the state to have a minimum security measure. This is the floor. No one can fall below this. Now, if you look at what the future of the Millennium Development Goals, Millennium Development Goals, just to recall, was a global UN program to eradicate poverty. When it was adopted, it did not contain the word disability or person. So they tried to address global poverty without expressly thinking of persons with disabilities. In the mid-term evaluation of the goals, this was somewhat corrected, and they recognized and acknowledged that without addressing poverty among persons with disabilities, no poverty eradication can happen to anyone. Yet, activists could not achieve a twin-tracked policy for the post-MDG continuation of the poverty eradication in the United Nations. What the state parties were willing to accept as an obligation is to mainstream disability into every social policy which has implications on poverty eradication. But we can see in advance, we can predict in advance that it is going to be very difficult to make it effective to ensure an economically and socially just society to ensure equal participation. That is why I do think that instead of SPF, social protection floor, what state should provide for persons with disabilities is a floor regarding equal access to social protection. So define a minimum level of social participation. Should be available using the resources, which are guaranteed as a core for all. And this should be taken into consideration when we set up the minimum laws regarding their benefits and other methods. The right to live in the community. If we go back to the tree metaphor, remember I said that legal capacity, right to legal capacity was the root of the tree. I would say that the right to live in the community is the fruit of the tree. The core of this right is the right to make choice. Where to live, with whom to live, on an equal basis with others. Again, there is a non-discrimination component. Non-discrimination is up to immediate realization. So whenever the authority says, look, you must go to a residential institution because there is no other way for you. They cannot legally force the person to go to a residential. The choice must be there. It must be on an equal basis with others. So it's not only that they must not legally. They cannot create in a situation where, in fact, the person will have no other choice than going into this. It does not mean that they have immediately provide all the supports and services in the community, near the residence of the person. That is something to be progressively done. But there is, in a core, it's very tricky. It should be provided immediately. I can't tell you what that core will contain. But it will be just more than the non-discrimination obligation. And I am really looking forward to seeing what the committee will say, hopefully in the future, near future, about the core obligations under Article 19 of this convention. And then there is the right to access the supports which the person needs, in the community, and this needs to be conceptual framework on what personhood means, and the three layers of personhood. So we hold it as the personal level, including the person who recognizes his or her own equal personhood. Then the institutional recognition, which was given in Article 12. And then still we said that the interpersonal recognition of personhood is required. Without that, person cannot really function, cannot enjoy personhood, full personhood on equal basis with others in the world. The person to be respected, loved, and valued as contributing to the society. So now, the supports which are required here, and also an obligation, and the content of the rights, is not really about the right to independence. If you look at the title of this article, it says that independent living and to live independently and being involved in the community. It can be easily misunderstood, and the criticism that it's a very Western, actually Nordic Western concept of an individual, especially individualistic approach, is not established. Because the real focus of the rights in this article is about the choice and the equal basis. Choice. But the choice is not only a choice between an institution or living on my own. The choice may include to live with my family, to live with my extended family, to live with my friends. And this should be an equal basis balance. In countries, cultures, communities, where most people live with their extended families, several generations may live together, the choice of an equal basis with others means also that very likely, if it is enjoyed by people with disabilities, most of them will choose the same setting. They will also want to live in their, with their extended families. They can't be forced. So because always there will be some dissidents who feel only on their own. It's very unlikely that after gaining positive experience of alternative institutions, I do not expect that too many people will be willing to go to large residential institutions. And you can see that there are real alternatives to that. Now, the interdependent nature of human existence is recognized in this convention, at least in two articles. Article 12, actually, then there is this duty to provide access to supports for exercising legal capacity. It does recognize that there are people who will exercise their legal capacity in an interdependent context. And Article 19, the right to live in the community, also does recognize this interdependent nature. So how human rights law can be functional and instrumental in bringing about structural changes? But I would say that some of the structural changes, you know, are not even in contradiction with individual approach. Because accessibility as a progressively realizable population in the state, I mean, you can conceptualize it without thinking of the individual completely. There are different structural changes which are less mechanical. Structural changes in societies and communities and relationship structures. And they require attitudinal changes and changes in everyday conduct. Exercise. Now, how effective law can be there, I don't know. I certainly think that law is not the only thing which we need to bring about the changes, including structural changes, including cognitive, cultural, and attitudinal ones. But still, I think that the law is an important component of that. Because any other component will be up to negotiations. And that's important. Because against people, we will never fully implement it. We have to engage with people. But law can be creatively and constructively used to facilitate engagement. Everyone must engage with the law. No one can say without consequences that, oh, it's a law, but I'm not engaging with it. The law applies to all. That's the strength. And the last is, the rest is advocacy, which is politics. So I'm coming to the very conclusion. How to achieve just society for all persons in this area. What we already see is that the entry into force of the CRPD internationally and the start of the monitoring internationally already made changes. Disability, the rights of persons with disabilities is already on the human rights agenda in the UN, in the EU, in most domestic arenas, including the IMF, who has not yet ratified it. It's very much there. I'm happy about that. The same is true about the policy arenas. Once a country ratifies, they have no option than putting the rights of persons with disabilities, and not disability as such, but the rights of persons with disabilities, on their policy agendas. They have to work on policies. What is still missing, I think everybody, at least not missing but weak, is to placing the rights of persons with disabilities into political agendas. And policy is important. Policy can do a lot of good. Policy mistakes can cause a lot of harm. Good laws can initiate changes, can drive changes, can be used as vehicles by advocates. Bad laws can cause harm. But neither law nor policy has the real engine to reach out community at large to really catalyze the changes to reach everyone. To really change the attitudes, to really change life on the grassroots. It is only politics which can achieve it, whether we like it or not. Now, disability, rights of persons with disabilities, persons with disabilities, ourselves, we are still politically very weak. We must engage in politics, we have no option. Otherwise, is still remaining a marginalized policy issue. We must engage. I personally feel that we must engage with politics, big allies. Just persons with disabilities on our own, we still are a minority, a big minority, a minority with the history of all oppression. We are not big enough. But if we can mobilize our families, if we can mobilize other marginalized groups, then we are no longer a minority. Then we become a majority. And that is what makes me optimistic that if we use all these arenas, the human rights arenas, the policy arenas, and we are already there, and we also learn how to engage with politics and not to be abused by politics, then we have a good chance that the changes that we have been dreaming about and working for will become true. Certainly we will not become complete in my life, but within one or two generations the world will be significantly different and much more just for the communities. Thank you very much. If you have urgent questions, then I suggest that informally you can call me. I don't want to.
Yes, thank you very much, Kevin.